I am Damian Hallberg from TV Guide Magazine. Thank you guys for being here for the Flash panel. I'm going to bring everybody out right now because that was baller and we got to talk about it. So first we've got executive producer Todd Helbing. Mr. Kenan Lonsdale. Candace Patton. Jesse L. Martin. Grant Gustin. Tom Cavanaugh. Miss Danielle Panabaker. Carlos Valdez. Yeah. And new to this crazy family, Mr. Tom Felton. And executive producer Aaron Helbing.
Oh wait, we started to follow up.
Love you!
All right, let's get right to this. Helbings, executive producers, how big are the changes that Barry has enacted?
Well, you saw a little, snippet of it.
Yeah.
I mean, this is something that, is going to ripple throughout the whole season. Obviously, Barry grew up now in a different family. His parents were still alive. He didn't grow up with Joe and Iris in his house. Cisco obviously has gone on to make some money.
I don't know what the hell's going on.
Grant's stealing your
thunder. I was doing a selfie.
Grant's still doing a selfie.
I'm done.
You're all on Grant's Instagram.
Does it undo him being zapped by the particle accelerator?
No.
All right. And we saw a quick glimpse of a couple characters in there that seem to be new to this Flashpoint. A certain black hooded masked person.
Yep.
What was that?
So we're doing a really cool thing this year that we haven't done before. We're doing two big bads. One is a speedster that we'll reveal later, but the other, the guy that you saw, the creepy guy with the mask, is Dr. Alchemy.
All right, okay. And what, Aaron, what can you tell us about Dr. Alchemy?
That certainly doesn't like the Flash. He's a bad dude, and he's going to be a formidable adversary to the Flash and everybody on the team throughout the season.
And again, much like last year, you've got the character and then you've got the voice. And you guys want to tell us who's doing the voice this year?
Yeah, it's going to be voiced by Tobin Bell.
So. You guys might know as Jigsaw.
Jigsaw. Nice.
Saw.
Jigsaw. Nice. Because you had to find the one person who was creepier than Tony Todd.
Yes, exactly.
And that would be Jigsaw.
Exactly.
All right, so David Ramsey and Stephen Amell have both mentioned this weekend that the Flashpoint Paradox will affect Arrow. Can you tell us anything about that?
It has its ripples throughout the whole universe, So one of the effects is with Diggle himself. I'm not going to be able to go into any detail, but you'll have to tune in and see exactly how.
Okay, all right. So let's get to our characters and our actors because, God bless them, you guys had a rough year. You guys went through it last year. Let's talk about this. Barry's actions. Barry.
Sorry.
He's. Grant, how is he going to be, how does he feel about these?
About these changes?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, first, Barry doesn't realize how much has changed. The whole reason he did this is so his parents would be alive, and they are. So I think when we find him, he's still kind of living in that, blind bliss and, just kind of ignoring what other changes are out there, or unaware, at least, when we first find him.
Okay. He tends to beat himself up a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And as things start to fall into place and he starts to realize the woman I love is the woman who does not know me.
Yeah. Well, he knows that I think Barry, he also knows though that conversation from the season 2 finale on the porch with Iris still happened. And they have, well, I mean, as far as he remembers, like he remembers that happening. So I think his plan is like, I'm just going to find her, like, and it's going to work out. Like, so, you know.
What's he going to do?
Good old Barry logic.
Barry logic. And how long, from the clip we saw, obviously it comes out that he's done this. How long is he going to sit on this secret?
Aaron, Todd?
Todd,
I mean, I guess kind of like, when we find him, it's been, he's been in this timeline for 3 months. He's been living in this timeline for 3 months. So he knows he didn't grow up with Joe. He didn't grow up with Iris. Joe and Iris and Barry are just kind of acquaintances. They went to school together. Barry's still a CSI, so he still knows Joe from work. But like I said, I think he's just kind of like, I'll figure the rest out like later. Like, I just need my parents alive and got that, so check.
All right. Is that how he talks?
Yeah, so, all right, we waited 2 seasons, and then this happens. Does this mean that we're going to have to wait, are we going to have to wait longer for West Allen to happen?
Are you guys waiting for us to answer that?
Somebody better take it.
I'll just say that I think in any timeline that Barry and Iris ultimately find each other.
And I feel like this actually gives us a chance to watch Barry court her, to like get to know her, you know, like start fresh, and we get
to see. You're such a romantic.
I'm a little bit romantic. I'm a little West Allener. I'll own it. Candace, Iris is amazing. She's just so great. And last year we got to see a lot of the characters develop into this new form of what they were capable of. And we saw you last year, and part of me at least, was like, she's so amazing, is she gonna wait around forever? Like, this girl is not gonna stay off the market long.
Oh, wow.
Hmm.
Wow, you think a lot of her. I love that, wow. I think the thing about Iris and staying off the market, I think she had to fully grieve the death of, mm-hmm. of Eddie. Obviously, Barry was involved with Patty at the beginning of season 2, and she was respectful of that relationship and quite supportive of that. And I think, you know, she had to come to a place in her life where she had grieved Eddie and was finally ready to move on. And we saw her try and do that with Scott Evans a little bit, her editor, which is a little suspect. Mm-hmm. And I think that catapulted her into realizing that if she was going to move on, that the person she really wanted to do that with was Barry Allen. And so I think it was a really great move on the writer's part. You know, when she was ready to move on, it took her a while. She didn't just rush into a new relationship. She waited, and she knew it should be with Barry.
One of the things also that loved seeing start to develop, and because of this kind of reset, the idea of Caitlin and Iris being friends and hanging out, like, you know, having that connection, where does this place them now? Because I ship them too.
Oh, wow. What do you call that?
Yeah, what's that ship name?
This shipping thing is ship wow. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what the female friendships are going to look like this season, but I think I would say for both of us that anytime we can have women on television that are friendly and supportive, I think we should do that. I love that.
Yeah.
And
it's so nice to see these characters not fighting over a guy.
Absolutely not. I don't. I would have issue with that as well.
Yeah. But Danielle, obsessed with Killer Frost.
Oh,
obsessed. Who knew you had it in you?
Well, thanks.
So was being bad so much more fun?
It was a treat. You know, it's so fun to be on a show where that's a possibility, where for 2 episodes, everybody in our cast did an unbelievable job with their Earth 2 doppelgangers. Like, you know, it's bonkers to look around on set and to see, you know, Reverb and Carlos and Cisco. It's really a testament to the show as a whole that we were able to pull that off.
What did you think when you saw her costume?
Oh, I loved it. It was so fun. I mean, we had a little bit of time to try a few different things. You know, the original wig that we tried for Killer Frost was like a short little pixie wig. And I was like, well, what if we put a little more hair in? And it just kept getting longer and longer and longer till what we ended up with.
Love it. All right, so she's had it rough. She's, you know, everyone she loves dies, is sucked into a portal, you know,
not
villainous.
Great.
They're erased from history. Any chance that with this new world that we can find her happy?
Sorry.
That didn't sound very sincere.
Yeah, it didn't sound sincere at all.
I hope so. Even if Grant doesn't, I hope
so. Of course I hope so.
Of course he does. We all do.
Well, nobody does heartbreak better, so.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. All right, Carlos. Carlos. Talk about a hero's journey. We got... what can you... Obviously, we now know what the question was, because we didn't see this clip until today, right now. My question was, what is the next step in his evolutionary, you know, development? But it looks like we get a very different Sisko.
Yeah.
Tell us about how he got there.
Well, so Barry turned back time. And he sort of created a different timeline in the process. Mm-hmm. Some would call that Flashpoint. And in that different timeline,
you got $1 billion.
Sisko is an ostentatious billionaire.
As he should be.
Yeah, he flossing. So there you go.
What is his specialty?
Making money.
Nice.
Like legitimately, like that's all his arc. The beginning of
just keep making money.
Like, he's always like flexing how much money he has and how rich he is. So that's pretty much his best qualities as a person is.
So does this mean no more like quips or movie lines or?
There are definitely quips. I think regardless of the fact that this is a different version of Sisko, I think the core is still the same. You know what I mean? He's still very quick. He's still an engineer at heart. He's fascinated with the way the world works, and he's very good at what he does. You know.
All right. Okay. And Jesse.
Yes.
Jesse. Joe West is the dad we all want.
Aww.
He is the dad we all want. But we also want Daddy to be happy.
Yes. Daddy wants to be happy too.
What?
Well, all right.
Where is he?
You mean with
when we,
happiness?
You know, in our new timeline, how's he doing?
He's very unhappy.
Oh my God.
He is. He's very unhappy. Things at home aren't going well. He's having a particular issue with his youngest and only daughter, mm-hmm. and it doesn't seem solvable. So Joe gets quite depressed about it, and it starts to affect his life, it starts to affect his work, and even though him and Barry aren't tight like that anymore, we do work together, Barry is the one that makes sure Joe still has a job, because things get so dire that Joe just doesn't want to do anything, to be honest. Yeah, so we're still in that journey to the happy thing.
Yeah, all right, okay. Tom Cavanaugh, AKA Carlos Vanez. Yeah. If Joe West is the dad we all want, Harrison Wells is the uncle we all fear.
Oh my God.
Yet his relationship with Jesse last season showed us a side of him that we had never known he was capable of. Now that he's off back into his own world, we still don't know how he comes back, but when he does come back, has his relationship with Jesse and the changes that have been triggered, have they mellowed him out?
Who knows, Damien, really? Like, you know, that's a solid, strong, eviscerating question, and I can't give the answer to that right now. I will say that it's enjoyable if by the time this season or this show is done its run, if I can get to triple digits in the number of characters that I play, that'll be a nice little bucket list thing checked off.
Well, that was the one thing I also wanted to ask Grant. How many times have you filmed your mother character's murder? I mean, how many times is this man going to show up in the living room?
No, I know. I mean, for real. I think we've we've been in that room shooting a version of that scene like at least, I want to say, 5-6 yeah. times. Yeah. I mean, it's, yeah, and Michelle, yeah. that plays Nora Allen, is like the most amazing actress, and it just like gets there every time. I can't think of that storyline without like welling up, but for real. Like, so I'm not gonna go there.
There you go. All right, Kenan Lonsdale. We saw what you're doing.
What'd you see? What'd you see?
What's up? How is Kid Flash?
He's good.
Yeah. He's good. Did you realize that you were going to end up in that suit so quickly after joining?
No, not so quickly. I mean, I had an idea that it would happen eventually, but yeah, when I got the script, I was like, oh, this is happening. Uh-huh. And I was actually having like not a great day that day, so that definitely made my day.
Nice. All right, and tell us about the costume.
Well, what do you guys think?
What do you guys think? Yeah. And what kind of speedster is he compared to Barry Allen?
I mean, there's similar qualities. He's Kid Flash, so I tried to play him with a really young, lighthearted, almost cockiness to him that it can sometimes be his downfall. But he is just in a really good place mentally. Like, he's never felt more sure of himself.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so between the Wests, the Wells, and the Allens, I feel like the Wests are the healthiest family in Central City. Wow. How is the dynamic with the three of you?
In real life?
Yeah.
Oh, in real life.
Pretty, pretty healthy.
Good, yeah.
These my peoples. Like, it's super healthy. I mean, I think the reason that we can sit down and have those great family scenes is, you know, we have such a great rapport with each other. And so when there's heavy work to do and there's emotional scenes, we just sit down and have the conversation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had family moments too, like when I picked Candace up from the airport and then Candace's car didn't work and then me, Jesse, and Kate, we're all just standing there like, what are we gonna do?
My car broke down and like Kenan had to come to my rescue. It was like real brother sister stuff.
And we got our papa there and he's telling us what to do. It's just like, it's like a real thing.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. We had to get a guy to jump my car. Guys, it like, was like
flash
a real
point,
family
though,
moment.
That's another story though.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you guys ain't so tight.
Nope.
Yeah. Thank you, Grant.
Sorry. Sorry again.
Sorry. Mr. Tom Felton.
Hello. Yeah. Thank you.
How about that?
Yeah, it's good to be back. Thank you.
So I think they recognize you.
It's surreal. It's. The last time I was here, I was representing a franchise symbolized by a lightning bolt.
Wow.
And here I am. So, yeah, that just hit me, like, now. It was weird.
I hadn't thought of that.
That is insane, actually.
It's kind of odd.
So, this character, Julian Dorn.
Yes.
We hear that he is smart, and he suspects Barry is hiding something.
You know more than I.
Okay, well, should we see this guy as a threat?
I think any character I play, you should see as a threat. I honestly don't know. I tried to get both of these writers tipsy last night to pry some information out of them and to no joy. So I'm not sure. I've the first two episodes that we're into so far, there's definitely some friction, shall we say, between Barry and Julian. He definitely sort of treads on the toes of Barry's expertise. Being a sort of forensic expert. So, yeah, there's some feathers ruffled pretty early on, so I'm intrigued to know where it goes.
All right, and anyone else maybe on this panel that Julian interacts with on a more pleasant level?
I think we're pretty pleasant with each other.
Yes, yes. Well, I didn't want to tell them about our romantic too soon.
That's why things aren't going well at home for Joe.
Yeah, I'm honestly, I don't know. It'd be much easier it'd be harder if I did know, but the fact that I don't, it's this man's fault. He's not told me anything. But it's exciting. It's. I know there's going to be a lot to sink my teeth into, and if the last two seasons have anything to go by, anything's possible.
Yeah.
I could literally be playing, I could be a woman by episode 6. So.
All right, so for the helpings, it sounds like you have given everyone here a new character to play. How great is that for the actors?
Awesome.
Yeah. So what is it like getting the scripts and saying, oh, like, this is not the this is not the Iris I was?
I mean, the thing about Flashpoint, I think, for my character, actually, is she's quite similar. But to your point, in, you know, Earth 2, we're all getting to play different versions of our characters. And you sign on to do a show, you think you're playing one character for that many years. This is one of the rare shows where you get to expand and play as an actor. And that's really exciting. It makes me excited to go to work, especially for many, many years to come. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hopefully.
For Grant and Jesse, for a lot of yours, it is, we know that if there's a possibility that you two are in a scene that's not in the police station, we're gonna cry. Like, if they're at a dinner table, we're dead. Right. Do you guys have that thing where you're like, oh, okay, so this is where we're gonna make people cry?
No.
Yeah, no.
No, I mean, I don't think we ever set out to make anybody cry. I mean,
but you do it all the time.
But not on purpose. I mean, help me out.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I don't think that's ever like a goal. It's just, it's good writing, good stories, and I think our real life bond is strong, and Barry and Joe's relationship is pretty special, and they've been through a lot, and it's interesting now because it's gotten to a point. I guess it's not that way anymore, but it had gotten to a point where Joe's always given Barry advice, but it's, you know, Barry kind of has been there for Joe as well.
Exactly.
It's a really cool relationship, but I don't think we ever set out to be like, y'all are going to cry.
Well, now that things have been kind of reversed, what is Barry's relationship with Harrison like?
Well, what do I say to that? I mean, Harry left.
Yeah.
And he's gone. So in Flashpoint, he's not around.
Not there.
Yeah. So it's non-existent, I guess.
Oh. Tom, that must be awesome for you.
What's nice is, you know, not being on the show, but being allowed to come down to Comic-Con and hang out with you.
Yeah.
I've been crashing on Jesse's sofa, and Grant's been bringing me food, and it's like, everyone's been
How'd
so
How'd you get on the
great.
Panel, by the way?
I don't know. They just like a little convincing talking, and
I got him in with this.
Yeah, it's great. It's really welcoming. It's nice. This is the kind of generous cast that I've been aligned with, so I'm grateful.
You're terrible.
One thing that we're grateful for from last season is the stuff that you and Carlos got to do. These two were hilarious.
Oh, my gosh.
That was so much fun to watch you two go at
Little
it.
Bolivian.
You're like the Bickersons.
Carlos.
How much fun was it developing that dynamic between you two?
Go, Los, go.
It was a blast. It was a blast, man. It was so fun.
It was amazing. It was incredible. We loved it.
It was incredible.
Nobody better than this guy. You throw yourself in with this guy, there's nobody better.
We made it so that we kept on talking on top of each other.
There's nobody better than Los. There's nobody better than
Los.
There's nobody better than Los.
That's so annoying.
So there you go.
That's the answer.
Amazing. All right.
Amazing.
I don't even know what happened just there. I think I may have just had a flashpoint. So when this panel was announced, I had tweeted out that Grant should prepare.
Yeah, you did, huh?
Yes.
I tweeted you back, too.
Because something that, when you guys started working together, Jesse and Grant, there was some off-camera cultural arts development.
Wow, that's nice.
Yes.
Put it.
Where you both started to dance, or at
we
least
we always had been.
You've always, but one of you could tap dance, one of you could not.
No,
we can both tap.
Yeah.
He's just a little better.
They
than
both
me.
Could tap.
He's just a little
better. He's better.
Well, we would like to see actually who is better.
Wow. Yeah. What did you teach me? Wow. What is the step? There we go. I literally tweeted him that I would not do that. But he suckered me in. And I like you guys.
Well, maybe Flashpoint will bring some more of that kind of stuff.
There you go. All right. Jesse, following that up, you got to sing on the show last season. And in the ultra stylish Earth 2, did that make you miss performing?
Yeah, man. I mean, I always miss that. I mean, first of all, we have a crazy schedule. So that gives us what, like about 2 months and some change?
2.5, yeah.
2.5 months off. So, you know, no Broadway producer is going to, you know, put together a show in 2.5 months because they want to make money. So it's going to be really difficult for me to find a space on stage for a while. Mm-hmm. Unless, of course, we create our own opportunities.
Which we talk about.
I like that idea. Flash musical. But it would be the Flash with an exclamation point.
Yeah,
you have to have that.
The Flash.
Yeah.
Flash question.
One of the things that everyone mentions this, that it is the Flash, but it's such a wonderful ensemble feeling. Is there anyone for you guys, for the actors, is there anyone on the stage that you just wish you had more scenes with and you're looking forward to working with more?
Candace and I don't have enough scenes together, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would the question be more volatile and perhaps more entertaining if it were less scenes with?
Yes, yes.
Oh, no.
Who do you want to work with less, Tom?
Oh.
No, I love working with you.
But you were looking
no,
at
I
me.
No, I looked at you, but I love
that.
Working
oh,
with you.
Oh, God.
Oh, I love working with you.
You're both pretty.
I love
both pretty. Both very pretty.
I'll do that all day.
And Keenan. I need more scenes with Keenan.
Yeah.
I'm just going to keep answering the question until someone else jumps in.
Yeah, we need to get him into the lab more.
I feel like we do get to work together a lot. We're all in Star Labs.
Yeah.
All the time.
That's true. You guys need more pizza nights.
It's true.
All right, so one of the things, a fan tweeted, have you guys figured out a way to, because you're going to have, something first of all, the crossovers.
Crossovers.
Especially the really fun one-offs where we get to see like Diggle turn up for the King Shark stuff or, you know.
I thought you were just saying Diggle turn up. Yeah. I was like, that'd be awesome. Just like Diggle
lit.
Shows up.
Let's go.
I got the shark. Do you have any lined up that you can announce right now?
Yeah, episode 2, we're going to have a little Felicity on the show.
And what can you tell us will she be doing?
She and Barry are...
She's giving advice.
Yeah.
Giving advice.
Giving advice. So for the helpings, something that somebody tweeted was, have you figured out a way to incorporate Iris into the crossovers? Because she wouldn't unless you guys can figure it out.
Are you saying that somebody actually tweeted me? Because I don't think anybody knows that I'm even on Twitter.
No, they tweeted me to ask you.
Okay.
So you have to answer or they won't leave me alone.
That's how it works.
Whenever we deal with the crossovers, it's this juggling feat of, you know, I mean, over the 4 shows, we have an immense cast. So we try to get everybody in as much as we can. But I don't know. It's... Every year we want to make them bigger and better and include more people. And right now, as I've been saying today, often it's this kind of like, we know what the story is, but it's future us's problem right now because it's such a big feat to try to figure that out.
And I've just realized while you were talking that if everything is different and Cisco is a billionaire, what does that do to the friendship with Caitlin, which is so great and so lovely and so like one of those rare male-female friendships on a show that doesn't go into a place of romance?
Aaron.
Yeah, Aaron.
Todd.
Look, I mean, I think it's very much like what these guys were saying is we want that too. We want these two women to have like this amazing friendship and it's not one that, you know.
Oh, I think they meant
Cisco and Caitlin. Cisco and Caitlin. Look,
I mean, everything's different in Flashpoint. That's what's exciting. So exciting.
That's all right.
Sorry, everybody.
I think we need to reevaluate some things.
Yeah. We all got wasted. Yeah.
We've been drinking back.
Which I missed it.
I was like, Cisco really changed.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
I mean, the thing about Flashpoint is there are many different changes that Barry discovers, and every character has different relationships with different characters, and you know, those are just a result of Flashpoint.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay.
That doesn't bode well.